Hello friends, I am Dr. Ankit Goyal. Today we'll be discussing the psychiatry portion of Grand Test 183. So let us start. The first question, question 167, asks, identify the test. So the options are A, Rorschach test, B, thematic A-perception test, C, sentence completion test, and D, neuropsychological test. So, the correct answer question 167 is option B, that is thematic A perception test. Now, let us discuss in details about the test. So, the correct answer is thematic A perception test or TAT. Now, what is thematic A perception test or TAT? This is a type of personality test. In fact, it is a type of projective personality test. Now, what do we mean by the projective personality test? Now, the principle behind projective personality test is that the way a person responds to a vague or ambiguous stimulus, this reflects person's inner conflicts, emotions, or feelings. So, this is the underlying principle behind the projective personality test, that is, the way a person responds to a vague or an ambiguous stimulus. Important to remember that the stimulus is vague and ambiguous, and it can be different for different individual. For example, a person A is responding to it in a different way than the person B, and subsequently this reflects their inner conflicts, emotions, or feeling. Or in other words, person projects his or her own feelings on the card. So, this is the underlying principle behind the projective personality test, and thematic A perception test is one of its kind. Now, when we discuss in detail about the TAT test, now first it was given by Henry Murray and Christiana Morgan. So, Murray and Morgan gave that test in 1935. Now, in this test, there are basically 30 cards, and one of the cards was shown in the question. Now, these cards basically depicts these card depicts basically various interpersonal relations. So, these card depicts various interpersonal relations, and there is a general instruction given to the person who is undergoing this test. Basically, the fundamental of this test is that a person has to write a very short and spontaneous story seeing the card. And the various general instructions which are given to the person on basis of which he has to write the story is that the person after seeing the card needs to interpret that what must have happened in the past which led to the current situation, what is currently occurring in the situation shown in the card, and who are these people, what are they doing, what is the predominant emotion, and what are they feeling, and also what are they thinking. And subsequently, the person also has to tell that what may be going to happen in the future. So, along these general principles, the person has to write a story. And based on the interpretation, of the story, various diagnoses are made. Now, there is also an Indian adaptation to this thematic A perception test, which was done by Uma Chaudhary. So So there is also an Indian modification of the thematic A-perception test. Now, other than the thematic A-perception test, various other projective tests of personalities include Rorschach test. It is basically Rorschach ink blot test. Now again, here the vague or the ambiguous stimulus is in the form of various ink blots, and subsequently the patient has to tell what the person is seeing in the ink blot. So again, this is again a vague or a ambiguous stimulus. Then other various tests includes draw a person test, then sentence completion test. So these are some of the other projective tests. Similarly, other than the projective tests, there are also objective test of personality. So now these are objective tests, or also known as the pencil and paper test. Now various tests included under the objective test of personality includes the questionnaire test. Now in which the person are giving options, person has to write either true or false, or there are statements the person has to tell either yes or no. Then another important objective personality test includes the MMPI or the Minnesota Multiphasic Personality Inventory. Which was given by Hathaway and McKinley. Now again, in this there are around 566 statements, and the person has to tell either true, false, or cannot say. And based on the interpretation and the analysis, the diagnosis is given. Now this is the, in fact, MMPI 1. Then there is another modification known as the MMPI 2, which include 567 such statements. Then third important objective personality test includes the CPI test or the California Psychological Inventory. That is the CPI test. So these are some of the objective as well as the projective personality tests. Now let us discuss the next question. Question 168. Now question 168 asks, the cell bodies of serotonergic neurons are located in what region of the brain? Option A, the midline raphe nuclei of the brainstem. Option B, the midbrain substantia nigra and ventral tegmental area. Then option C, locus ceruleus and the lateral tegmental noradrenergic nuclei. And fourth is the tuberomammillary nucleus of the posterior hypothalamus. So the correct answer to question 168 is option A, that is midline raphe nuclei of the brainstem. Now let us discuss this in detail. So the answer is 168 is option A, that is the midline raphe nuclei of the brainstem. Now let us discuss the neurotransmitter system. What are these systems? The neurotransmitter system in the brain are basically clusters of cell bodies which are restricted in few subcortical or the brainstem region. So the neurotransmitter system in our body or in the brain is actually a cluster of various cell bodies, and which are restricted in few subcortical or the brainstem region. Now one of the important neurotransmitters in our brain is the serotonin. Now the serotonin cell bodies are located in the midline raphe nuclei of the brainstem. So this is the location, very important to remember. Now again we can remember, the serotonin cell bodies are located in the brainstem. Now these are the rostral raphe nuclei and the caudal raphe nuclei. Now the rostral raphe nuclei, these are ascending to the brain. These are ascending branches to the brain upwards, and the caudal raphe nuclei are the downgoing branches which go to the medulla, cerebellum, as well as the spinal cord. Now the serotonin is derived from tryptophan, from the amino acid tryptophan. And important to remember that in the CNS, less than 2% of serotonin of the body is found. So CNS only constitute less than 2% of the overall serotonin in the body, while 80% of the serotonin is in the GIT tract, the platelets, as well as the mast cells. So the GI tract, platelets and the mast cells, they constitute nearly 80% of the serotonin of the body. Similarly, the second important neurotransmitter in the body is the dopamine. And the dopamine cell bodies are situated mainly in the midbrain, and especially two important regions to remember: substantia nigra and the ventral tegmental area, the VTA. Again, it can be remembered that dopamine is present in the midbrain. Now also important to remember that dopamine is derived from the amino acid tyrosine. Now tyrosine in the body is converted to DOPA, subsequently to dopamine, and then dopamine converted to norepinephrine and epinephrine. So important to remember tyrosine. Now the third important neurotransmitter system in our body is the norepinephrine, and the cell bodies are situated in the pons and the medulla region. And important regions include locus ceruleus and the lateral tegmental noradrenergic nuclei, which is one of the options in the question, or the NLTN. So again, important to remember these two important regions for the norepinephrine. Similarly, other important neurotransmitter include histamine, and the clusters of cell bodies of histamine are mainly situated in the posterior hypothalamus. In the tuberomammillary nucleus. So histamine is situated in the posterior hypothalamus, important to remember. Then another neurotransmitter found in the body is the acetylcholine. Now there is no specific restricted group of region of cell bodies in which acetylcholine is secreted. In fact, it is the majority of the choline is transported from the blood. So these are some of the important characteristics of various neurotransmitter systems in the body. Question 169, the most common site of brain tumors is option A, the frontal lobes, option B, the occipital lobe, option C, diencephalic region, and option D, pituitary gland. So the correct answer of this question is option A, the frontal lobes. So answer to question 169 is option A, that is the frontal lobe. Now let us discuss about the various locations of the brain tumors as well as the various psychiatric and behavioral symptoms with which all of these present. Now it is important to remember first that nearly 47 to 94% of the cases of the brain tumors may present with. So the clinical presentation or the first presentation of brain tumors may be psychiatric and behavioral symptoms. So when psychiatric and behavioral symptoms sometimes present abruptly, acutely, and there may be certain neurological signs and symptoms present, so one must try to rule out various other organic possibilities, and brain tumors is one of such possibilities. So nearly 47 to even 94% of brain tumors can first present as psychiatric and behavioral symptoms. And in fact, around 18% of the psychiatric and behavioral symptoms may be the first indication of brain tumors. So nearly 18% may in fact present the first symptom presentation of the brain tumors in nearly 18% of the cases may be only psychiatric and behavioral symptoms. So it is very important to understand this. Now, based on the location, let us discuss the percentages of brain tumors or the percentages of the overall tumor as well as the percentage of these patients which present with of cases with psychiatric and behavioral symptoms. So let us discuss few of the important points regarding this. Now, first, the frontal lobe tumor, in fact, the most common. So the percentage of frontal lobe tumors are around 22%, and very important to remember that up to 90% of these have up to 90% of them have psychiatric and behavioral symptoms, very high percentage, so very important. Then second are the temporal lobe tumors. Now again, they also roughly have a similar percentage, so also around 22%. And here the percentage of psychiatric and behavioral symptoms is around 50 to 55%. Then parietal lobe and occipital lobe, they have somewhat lesser percentage. Parietal lobe tumors around 12% of the overall tumors, and the occipital even less than that, that is around 4%. And also very less, around 16% of the parietal lobe tumors present with psychiatric and behavioral symptoms, and around 25% of them of the occipital lobe. Again, not very important to remember, but very important to understand. Thus, frontal lobe tumors, around 90% of them present with psychiatric and behavioral symptoms. And also, as also in given one of the options, the diencephalic tumor, the region of the tumors of the diencephalic region, which includes the thalamus, the hypothalamus, and the region around the third ventricle. Now, they roughly have a very less percentage of overall tumor percentage, but the psychiatric and behavioral symptoms here also can be as high as 50%. So, 50% of the cases may have psychiatric and behavioral symptoms as one of the components. So, again, very important to remember. So, very important to remember that the frontal lobe tumors, generally considered most common, but also temporal lobe also have a similar kind of percentage of overall tumors. Question 170, which of the following infectious agents have been associated with the onset of obsessive compulsive disorder or OCD? Now option A is streptococcal infection, option B Borrelia burgdorferi, option C retrovirus, and option D influenza virus. So here the correct answer is option A, that is streptococcal infection. So answer to question 170 is option A, that is streptococcal infection. Now let us understand the very important unique entity known as pandas. Now, PANDA stands for psychiatric, or in fact, stands for pediatric autoimmune neuropsychiatric disorder associated with the streptococcal infection. So, there is an entity known as pediatric autoimmune neuropsychiatric disorder associated with streptococcal infection. Now, there is a hypothesis, autoimmune hypothesis to this syndrome, to the PANDA syndrome. There is an autoimmune hypothesis which states that because of the group A streptococcal infection in the body, there is production of autoantibodies, which basically target the basal ganglia, and subsequently which lead to presentation of various other symptoms like OCD or tics or various other movement disorders. So this is the hypothesis which is given for the basis of development of PANDAs. Now when do we call it to be PANDAs? Now there are various criteria given when we diagnose. So it is basically present, there is presence of OCD and or tic disorder. So there may be OCD with or without even tic disorder may be present, and it is generally prepubertal onset. So generally in the prepubertal period there is onset of this syndrome. Then generally the course is episodic. So there is episodic course of symptoms, or the symptom severity increase and decrease in episodes. And also, as we had discussed, these are associated with, or these are associated with group A beta hemolytic streptococcal infection. And there is association of neurological abnormality. So there is also certain neurological abnormalities are also present. So these are some of the important criteria by which we diagnose a person with PANDAS. And also very important to remember that the PANDAS may account for substantial cases of childhood onset OCD and related disorder. So let us suppose a child at a prepubertal age has developed fever, sore throat, and we could find that there is beta hemolytic streptococcal infection. Subsequently, there is present of OC symptoms, obsessive compulsive symptoms, and or tic symptoms or tic disorder with some neurological abnormality. Subsequently, we would diagnose it as PANDAS. So this was about a very important disorder, and very important to remember it is associated with the streptococcal infection. So it's very important to remember that it is associated with the streptococcal infection. Question 171, Premarks principle. The Premarks principle states that people will, option A, people will attribute other people's behavior to stabilize their own personality traits. Option B, high frequency behaviors can be used to reinforce low frequency behavior. Option C, a person can learn by imitating the behavior of another person. And option D, the more people feel capable of controlling a threatening event, the less anxious they will be. So the Premarks principle is, the correct answer is option B, that is high frequency behavior can be used to reinforce a low frequency behavior. Now let us understand about Premarks principle. So the answer to question 171 is B, high frequency behavior can be used to reinforce a low frequency behavior. Now this was given by David Premarks. Now based on his observation, what he observed that if children are given two options in this, either to play pinball or eating candy, if both are freely available, what David Premarks observed that children would play more with pinball rather than eating candy. So subsequently he made playing pinball contingent on eating certain amount of candy. So what he did was that he made the playing of pinball contingent on eating a certain amount of few amount of candy. So before playing pinball, the children had to eat a certain or specific amount of candy. Subsequently, this increased the children with eating candy. So as we can see, a high frequency behavior of playing pinball can be used to increase a low frequency behavior of eating candy. So this is the Prema principle. This is also known as grandma's rule. So very simply putting it, that if you eat your spinach, only then you can have your dessert. So simply, it's also known as the grandma's rule. So again, so the answer was option B. Then question 172, there is an image given and you asked to describe this behavior which is shown in the image. The options given are option A, catatonia, option B, narcolepsy, option C, mania, and option D, depression. So the correct answer to this of 172 is option A, that is catatonia. Now catatonia is a cluster of various motor symptoms which may be present. Now important to remember that the concept catatonia and the term catatonia was described by Carl Ludwig Kalbaum. So catatonia was given by Carl Ludwig Kalbaum or Kalbaum. Now various clinical presentations of catatonia. Now there are a lot of clinical features, symptoms and signs which can be seen in catatonia. It may be in some patients there are few and in some patients there may be other few. So it is not compulsory that all the patients should have all the clinical features. So let us discuss some of the various important clinical features of catatonia. The first is the stupor. So in stupor, there is no or very severe limitation of the psychomotor activity. So there is no or very decreased psychomotor activity. Then second is mutism. Now again in mutism, there is no or very restricted verbal response. So just like we mute the television set, there is the patient becomes mute. So there is no or very decreased verbal response. Then third important clinical feature includes agitation. So the person may be very severely agitated, may not sit and may in fact even become violent. So agitation. Then there may be posturing. Now as this was shown in the picture which we had seen in the question, so posturing again a very important clinical feature of catatonia. Now what is posturing? Posturing is a spontaneous and active maintenance of posture which is held against gravity. So very important to remember that it is an active maintenance. So the person himself or herself is maintaining this posture. So for example, a person with catatonia may comes and maintains this posture for a long duration of time, and it may be for few minutes to even for hours, and it is held against gravity. So this is posturing. Similar to posturing, there is another important clinical feature known as catalepsy. Now again, catalepsy is again similar to posturing, but here there is spontaneous and passive maintenance of posture held against gravity. So now here in catalepsy, again there is maintaining of the posture, but now this is a passive posture. That is, if an examiner, let us say, has held your hand, like held the hand of the patient like this, now the patient will maintain this posture for a long duration of time. So this is catalepsy. Again, important to remember, it is catalepsy, while another similar term, cataplexy, is seen in narcolepsy. So now this is important to remember and should not be confused. So in catatonia it is catalepsy. Then sixth important clinical feature of catatonia is negativism. Now here the person tries to resist whatever the person has been told to do, or he in fact do the opposite. So for example, if a person is asked to come forward, so rather than coming forward, the person would go backwards. So he will resist, or he will in fact do the opposite of what he is being told to do. Or for example, if examiner, while examining a person, tries to pull the hand of the patient, so the patient would in fact try to resist it, either with the same force, and sometimes it may be even with a much larger force than the patient. And sometimes when it becomes extreme, so when there is extreme negativism, this is known as, important term to remember, this is known as Gaggenhalten. So Gaggenhalten is a extreme form of negativism. Now opposite to negativism is the automatic obedience. Now here that the person will automatically follow all the instructions of the examiner, even though it may be harmful to the patient, but he will automatically be obedient to the all the instructions of the examiner. For example, if a patient, if a person or the patient is asked that he has to pull his tongue out from the mouth despite being told that his tongue will be pricked with a pin. So despite knowing that, giving those instructions, he would still pull out his tongue. So this is automatic obedience. Again, the milder form of automatic obedience is known as mitmachen, and when it becomes severe, it is known as mitgehen. So suppose in mitgehen, an examiner just with a finger only push the patient, and the person is so much obedient to this command that the person may even fall, the patient may even fall backwards. So this is mitgehen. This is very severe form of automatic obedience. Then other important clinical signs and symptoms include stereotypy and mannerism. Now stereotypy, mannerism, both are odd, repetitive movements. So both are odd, repetitive movements. While stereotypy is non-purposeful or non-goal directed, and mannerism is purposeful or goal directed. So for example, a person is doing this kind of action repetitively, although it is of some purpose or it is goal directed, but it becomes odd and it becomes repetitive, hence it is mannerism. Similarly, certain movements, if a person is doing such movements, now these movements have no purpose, they are not goal directed, so these become stereotypy, but both are odd and repetitive movements. Then 10th important clinical feature of catatonia is grimacing. Now grimacing is odd facial movements like puckering of exaggerated puckering of lips. So there may be grimacing. Then other important are the another very important clinical feature is waxy flexibility. Now in waxy flexibility, now this is a sign which generally can be seen. Now when we have a candle of a wax candle and when we try to mold it, there will be initial resistance and subsequently it will be very easily molded. Similarly in this, the patients initially will show resistance while examining, but subsequently they may be molded just like a wax candle. So this is known as waxy flexibility, again a very important clinical feature. So again it is a very important clinical feature of catatonia, very important to remember. Waxy flexibility, when asked, it is basically they are asking about catatonia. Then the next important clinical features are echolalia and echopraxia. Now in echolalia, the patient mimics what the examiner or people around are saying. He will mimic. For example, if a therapist or a doctor asks a patient, what is your name? So rather than replying the name, the patient will again say, what is your name? So he will repeat whatever the examiner is saying. While in echopraxia, the patient will either mimic or repeat the examiner's action. So for example, if the examiner is writing something, so patient may also mimic and may also start writing, although he would not be having any pen and paper, but he will mimic the action. So this is echopraxia. So these are some of the very important clinical features of catatonia one must remember. Another important point to remember in catatonia, that there is a catatonia rating scale. So Busch Francis catatonia rating scale, or also known as BFCRS. Now it has 23 items, and again important to remember that the first 14 items are used for screening. So they are used for screening for catatonia. So very important to remember the Busch Francis catatonia rating scale. Next question, question 173. Double depression is characterized by option A, two family members with major depressive disorder concurrently, recurrent major depressive disorder with current symptoms twice as disabling as usual, two episodes of major depressive episode per month consistently, and option D, recurrent major depressive disorder superimposed with dysthymic disorder. So correct answer is option D, that is recurrent major depressive disorder which is superimposed with a dysthymic disorder. So answer to question 173 is option D. Now if we see, let us depict on a timeline how to describe double depression. Now double depression is basically a literature which was historically used in literature. Now according to this, there is a, if we say, now these are the, this axis Y is for symptoms and X axis is for the timeline. So if a person, now the lower axis represent depressive symptoms while the up axis is for the manic symptoms. So if we say that this is the threshold for a depressive episode, so in double depression, there will be a period of dysthymia, and subsequently it will be succeeded by an episode of major depression. So this is a double depression. And it should be remembered that there is no period of full remission between the episode. So there is no period of full remission between the episode. So important to remember that there should be no full remission, should not be there between these episode. And around 20 to 25 patient with a major depressive disorder have a such kind of a presentation. So again, it is important to understand and also clinically you see such patients. Now the question 174, intermittent explosive disorder, option A is associated with lower than expected rates of depressive disorders in the first degree relatives of patient. Option B is typically seen in small men with avoidant personality features. Option C, it is characterized by discrete episodes of aggression. And option D, it is relatively common. So here the correct answer is option C, that is, it is characterized by discrete periods of aggressive behavior. So answer to question 174 is option C. Now let us discuss about this entity, intermittent explosive disorder. So intermittent explosive disorder, now it is important to remember that it is a new entity which is described in DSM-5. So it's a new entity which has been described in DSM-5, and it is basically described in the disruptive impulse and conduct disorder group. So in DSM-5, in the group with disruptive impulse and conduct disorder, basically this is described. Now what is the intermittent explosive disorder? Here in intermittent explosive disorder, there is recurrent behavioral outburst and there is repetitive repeatedly failing to control aggression or impulse. So here there is recurrent behavioral outburst and the person is having repetitively failing to control his aggression and his impulses, which may present as, so this behavior may present either as verbal or physical aggression. Here there is no, in verbal or physical aggression, there is no damage to property or harm to other people. So, and such episodes should occur for at least 2 per week. So at least if 2 such episodes occurring per week for, so 2 episodes if occurring per week for around 3 months, then we may say that it is intermittent explosive disorder. Or there may be 3 behaviors in which there is severe damage. So damage becomes very severe. So there may be damage to property, damage to people, and in a year. So if there are 3 severe behaviors damaging property in a year, or there may be verbal and physical aggression with such acts occurring twice every week for around 3 months, then we call it as intermittent explosive disorder. Again, very important. Now some of the important points to remember here is that the chronological age the chronological age should be at least 6 years. So it cannot be diagnosed in children with less than 6 years of age. So the chronological age should be at least 6 years. It should not be because of some other disorder. So if there is other possibility of various other disorder, let us say psychosis, depression, in that, if the person is doing so, then we will not call it a intermittent explosive disorder. Then we will term it as that specific entity. Then they are generally out of proportion of the stressor. So there may be a stressor involved, but the stressor would not be so high that the person should react that way. So majority of the people, if under that kind of a stressor, would not react in this severe intensity. Also, it is generally not premeditated. So it is not pre-planned, it just occurs. So there is, because there is problem of impulse control. Then also it causes significant distress. So there is significant distress and marked dysfunctioning of the individual. Now also it is important to remember that the first degree relatives, basically they have more or increased depressive disorder. So there is increased chances of relatives with depressive disorder, impulse control disorder. So there is impulse control disorders, high percentage of first degree relatives with impulse control disorder and substance use disorder. So as in the question it was given low, no, it is high. The risk to in the first degree relatives of these disorder is high. Then also important to remember that these are not very common and these are in fact uncommon. So this was about intermittent explosive disorder. Question 175, which of the following is true of kleptomania? Now option A, children and adolescents who steal become kleptomaniac adults. Men are most likely to present for psychiatric treatment. Men are more likely to be sent to prison. And option D, patients only steal from stores. So the correct answer is option C, that is men are more likely to be sent to prison. So option of question 175, the correct answer is option C. Now let us discuss about kleptomania, or also known as pathological stealing. Now in ICD-10, it is described under habit and impulse control. Now, few important points one should understand about kleptomania. First, that these episodes of stealing, these are not planned. And also that the person, whatever the person is stealing, these are not needed for any personal use or any monetary use. So person is not stealing because of some personal use, that he will use it personally or for get some money from that. No, it is not for that. And also here, it is the act of stealing which is the goal and not the thing which is being stolen. Or so the act of stealing, so that there is so much problem in controlling this impulse to steal, the person is not able to. So the act of stealing is actually the goal. Now if we see the epidemiology of kleptomania, the male is to female ratio is around 3:1, or in fact it is 1:3. So the male is to female ratio is 1:3, and generally it begins in childhood. So it may begin in childhood, but females may present at the age of 35 years, while males may present at the age of 50 years. So even though it may present, may begin in childhood, it is not that all the person will continue that, but generally if they, so in females the age of presentation generally is 35 years and while in male it is around 50 years. Now females are more likely to present for psychiatric evaluation. So females are will be more likely to present for psychiatric evaluation, while males are generally more likely to be sent to prison. So males will be more likely to be sent to prison. So these are some of the important points about kleptomania. Question 176. All of the following are found in family members of trichotillomania patients except. So A, sexual dysfunction, option B, tics, option C, impulse control disorder, and option D, obsessive compulsive symptoms. So the correct answer is option A, that is sexual dysfunctions. So the correct answer of question 176 is option A, that is sexual dysfunction. Now let us understand few important points about trichotillomania. Also known as hair pulling disorder. So this term trichotillomania was given by a French dermatologist with the name Francois Halopieu. So he gave the term trichotillomania, which is also known as hair pulling disorder. Now in ICD-10, it is described under habit and impulse disorder, while in DSM-5, it is now described under obsessive compulsive and related disorders. Basically, there is a marked intense impulse of the person to pull his hair, and subsequently it decreases some tension only when the person is able to pull the hair. So this is trichotillomania or the hair pulling disorder. Now if we see, the most common area to be involved, or the most common area from which the person pulls the hair, is the scalp, and then there may be other areas like eyebrows, eyelashes, beard, there may be other armpits, so, or in fact even in other rare cases maybe even the pubic hairs. So nearly all the areas which the person is accessible can pull the hair, but the most common region or area is the scalp. Now if we see the comorbidities, the person with trichotillomania may have various comorbidities like obsessive compulsive disorder, anxiety disorders, depressive disorders, there may be eating disorders, personality disorders may be there, especially obsessive compulsive personality disorder and borderline personality disorders. Then there may be various other syndromes like the Tourette syndrome, or tic disorders may be associated. So these may be some of the important comorbidities of patient with trichotillomania. If we see the family members, in family members there may be increased risk of various disorders like tics, impulse control disorder, obsessive compulsive disorder, eating disorders. Again, in personality disorders, there may be obsessive compulsive personality disorders, then borderline personality disorder, and even narcissistic personality disorders. So there may be increased risk of family members with these. So, and there is no such indication of increased risk of sexual dysfunction in the family members. Hence, the answer is option A. So thank you for your time.